Good morning. Welcome to worship today. So good to see you. So great to have the kids here to sing. So there's a cool verse in Zephaniah chapter 3. You might have heard it before. Zephaniah chapter 3. The Lord your God is with you, the mighty warrior who saves. He will take great delight in you. In his love, he will no longer rebuke you, but will rejoice over you with singing. Now, isn't that a picture? God in heaven singing over us. I wonder what he's singing. Can't wait to get to heaven to see. Amen. So let's lift up our praises. Enjoy.
Joyful, joyful, we adore you, God of glory, Lord of love. Hearts unfold like flowers before you, opening to the sun above.
Melt the clouds.
Melt the clouds of sin and sadness. Drive the dark of doubt away. Giver of eternal gladness, fill us with the light of day.
You are the one.
You are the one who saves. You are the one who saves. You are the one whose hands lift us from the grave. You are the light of life, the everlasting day. You are the one who takes all our sins away. You are giving and forgiving, ever blessing, ever blessed. Fountain of the joy of living, ocean depths of happy rest.
To the one.
You are the one who saves. You are the one who saves. You are the one whose hands lift us from the grave. You are the light of life, the everlasting day. You are the one who takes all our sins away. Jesus, you are my rescue. Jesus, you are my rescue. I give you everything I have. Jesus, you are my rescue. Jesus, you are my rescue. I give you everything I have. You are giving and forgiving, ever blessing, ever blessed. Fountain of the joy of living, ocean depths of happy rest. You are the one who saves. You are the one who saves. You are the one whose hands lift us from the grave. You are the light of life, the everlasting day. You are the one who takes all our sins away.
You're the one.
You are the one who takes all our sins away. You are the one who takes all our sins away.
Well, good morning, everybody. We welcome you to worship today. What a great day today is, a great day to celebrate and give praise to our God for the gifts that he continues to pour out upon us. Just a couple of announcements. Number one is we still have flip-flops on that back bulletin board. We love to sponsor all our preschoolers and the incoming preschoolers that will be here. We don't know who they all are yet, but we know that God will lead the right people here. And we would love to make sure that we sponsor them in the correct and in most positive way. So if you can, if you have, and if you would like to, grab a flip-flop, take it home, bring it back with $15 in it. That will help buy them a Crown of Life t-shirt and also an arch book that we'll deliver to them personally this summer. And then pray for them and let them know that you care and are loving them. So if there's any other possible way, or if you've already done it, thank you. If you've done it and would like to take more, please do. If you know other people that would like to take some, please help them out in a special way. But we really want to try to get those flip-flops all gone here in the next couple weeks, because we want to make sure that every one of our preschoolers will be taken care of when they come to the start of the school year here after the summer break. The other thing is this, is we've done so many amazing things this summer, the last few years. And in fact, when I say the last few years, I'm talking way back to 2020. And if you know what happened in 2020, you can understand. But God has been really amazingly good and has truly blessed this place in so many different ways. For the last 4 years, I've pushed you through change. And the reason why I'm pushing is pulling you would stop and you would fight. But pushing means I'm just giving you the little pat in the rear end and saying, hey, let's go. And certainly God has been good. We've done so many different things in 4 years, and some of them are just listed here. We've changed our logo, our mission. We've changed the preschool staffing has changed. We've got the color of our sanctuary. You all remember what that looked like, right? In 2020? Those that didn't, you're so lucky, right? But we changed the color of the sanctuary. We've added the gathering place. We have the children's corner. Extra areas and staffing has been helpful, and God has truly blessed us in that way. We've had children's church. We've changed the way we do sermons and been relational into Scripture. And then we're also into our investment into the preschool. God has been good, and we continue to move forward. But that doesn't mean that we have to, like, just keep going gung-ho. It actually means right now we need to take a season of Sabbath. Because we need to be prepared for what's next, the next season that God will lead us in. And when I say the next season that God will lead us in, there are so many great things that can happen and are still continuing to happen. But sometimes it takes a moment just to sit back and take a deep breath and really listen to God. And so starting in the month of May, on May 1st through the end of May, every day, Monday through Friday, I will be spending an hour in prayer. Some of the time will be during the day, and then some of the time will be in the evening. And I'm going to encourage you to join me in this time. I'm going to encourage you to take a moment, and if you can, just to pray with me. So that hour time slot out in the narthex table is the sheet of the times that will be here. We set up a little prayer section for us to do it, for me to do that, and for you to come and pray also. But for that time period, there's two slots each for a half hour. And if you can come and sit and pray with me, I would love that. I would love that. But please note that if you can't, I totally understand. But I'm going to encourage you, I'm going to challenge you to just take a moment through your day and just stop and pray and really hear what God tells you. Don't just pray and pour what you want from God, but pray and thank God for everything He's blessed us with, and then listen to what God is telling you so that we know where we are going to go next. And I'll be praying for you. I'll be praying for each one of you. Why? Because God has certainly blessed you, and God is still working within you. And so I'm going to be praying for you and for those that we don't always see, that God will continually walk with us in this time. We do mission, and we've been mission money, and one set of mission money went to Concordia Ann Arbor, and thank goodness for Concordia Ann Arbor and the fact they are going to be staying open. But we sent mission money to help a student there that is going through church work, and we received a letter from Kimberly Bauer. Kimberly is actually an education student at Concordia Ann Arbor, going to become a Lutheran school teacher. And she writes, I want to thank you for all that you have done for me. Your kindness and support and generosity have not gone unnoticed, and I truly appreciate everything that you have done. I'm grateful for your support and investment in my academic journey, and I hope that to one day pay it forward and help others in need. God's blessings, Kimberly Bauer. And so we give thanks for Kimberly, for the desire that she has to be a servant of our Lord and to serve as a teacher. And so please keep Kimberly in your prayers as she continues her studies and her journey in Christian education. And that the lives that she'll touch, we know will be blessed. But then also we have another blessing that we've been supporting. And so we're going to invite up Patty from Gifts for All God's Children just to speak a few words of the amazing things they are doing.
Thank you. Thank you, Pastor. Thank you to Crown of Life. We are so blessed to be one of your mission partners, and the funds that we receive go through all of our programs all year long in the city. We primarily work in the inner city, actually, in Detroit and Pontiac and Flint, and I look back, we've had a long history with this church. In like 1999, one of the members, Kathy, actually started working with us at Christmas and did Christmas here many years. The congregation sponsored children. And then in 2008, before your basement was a preschool, it was just a basement with no heat actually down there. And they used to do rummage sales and things. We were allowed to use your basement for actually 10 years. We would move in November. The eighth grade class at St. John would move us here with all our boxes and all our brand new clothes and toys. And we would stay here through the Christmas season, and all the volunteers would come downstairs and wrap gifts, and we would pick them out for the children. And then we would move out again in January into a storage unit. So things have changed since 2018 when we moved out of your basement, and you began your preschool, I think, shortly after that. But we now are renting at downtown Rochester in the First Congregational Church. We have a whole area there near the food pantry, and we all year long collect brand new toys, brand new clothes, and we buy things when they're 90% off after Christmas, all warm clothes, so that we have extra things for gifts for the children. But we began in really 1987 as a Christmas outreach. I was on that committee at Faith Lutheran in Troy, never dreaming God was going to do what he did with Gifts for All God's Children. So we began that Christmas with 187 names of children from three inner-city Detroit churches that we sponsored at Faith. So then all these years later, you know, it's been 35 years, I can't believe it, I think something like that, we've sponsored over 88,000 children over those years. And this past year, okay, so we went from three churches to 36 different churches and schools and businesses that sponsored kids. We went from 187 children back then to 3,029 we provided gifts for last Christmas. And we worked with 47 ministries. So we went from three ministries in Detroit to 47 churches and ministries throughout Detroit, Pontiac, Flint, and other areas. So God had a plan for Christmas, but he even had a bigger plan for year-round ministry and what we're really supposed to be doing. We have prayer as our foundation. We have three prayer ministries. We have Prayer Impact that meets twice a month, and we pray for everything that we do, and we ask God to lead us, and he has been so faithful with that prayer ministry. And prayer for the children, we have people that sign up to pray for the families and the kids, and we send them an email scripture once a week with a different prayer to pray for the children that we are impacting. And then today we're having prayer for the city down in Detroit in one of the churches. I need to go there after here. And we pray for all the different churches and businesses, everything in the city. So prayer is our foundation. There's many challenges in the city with the children and the families, and there's many that don't have food, and they don't have clothes to wear, and they don't have the things that we take for granted here. And so God has used Gifts for All God's Children to help reach those kids. We partner with the frontline ministries, which are the churches in the city, and they reach out into their neighborhoods and help the children get connected to the churches, and then we reward the behavior. So if the children start coming to East Bethlehem in Detroit or one of our churches, then they get put on our Christmas list and they get Christmas gifts. So they're not just given to random kids. They're actually help encourage the families to be part of the church. So one quick story I'll tell you about is East Bethlehem, unless Pastor has the thing, and I can have two more minutes or so. We have a little girl there named Erica. She was born, her mom was a single mom and 16 years old when she was born. And she started coming to East Bethlehem. She hadn't gone to school, but her mother had gone there. And the school closed in 06. And East Bethlehem is on the corner of Mound and East Outer Drive in Detroit. So when the school closed, it's by 2008, 2009, they didn't have any children left. And the church and the things were, it was not going well there. We met with them. We said we would help them reach out. So we started all these programs at East Bethlehem year-round, and Erica got to come to the Valentine party. She got to come to the Easter fair and get Easter, you know, her Easter basket. She got to come to summer camps that we run there, like 4 weeks of summer camp and all kinds of tutoring then that we began a number of years ago, too. And then so we have poured into this little girl's life. She got to go to away camp, the Wildwood Ranch, even in the summer because of this partnership. And now she's like changed from what she was, and she has hope, and she has this relationship with this church. So God has been good. He's had a plan, and we really thank Crown of Life, Pastor, for all you do. Amen.
Amen. Thank you so much for sharing that. God's blessed us in so many ways. He blesses his children. He forgives us. He heals us. He redeems us through Jesus. He's given us steadfast love and mercy. He satisfies us with good things. He gives us renewal. He is righteous. And he gives us justice. So many things to praise God for. So we want to bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that that is within me. We want to bless your holy name. Bless the Lord.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. I worship your holy name.
Let's stand up and sing.
The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. I worship your holy name.
You're rich in love.
You're rich in love, and you're slow to anger. Your name is great, and your heart is kind. For all your goodness, I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. I worship your holy name. Bless the Lord. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. I worship your holy name. And on that day when my strength is failing, the end draws near and my time has come, still my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and then forevermore.
Forevermore.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. I worship your holy name. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. worship your holy name. Worship your holy name. Lord, I worship your holy name.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us confess our Christian faith together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The Holy Gospel according to St. John, the 10th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. It says, I am the Good Shepherd. The Good Shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. He who is a hired hand and not the shepherd, who does not own the sheep, sees a wolf coming and leaves the sheep and flees, and the wolf snatches them and scatters them. He flees because he is a hired hand and cares nothing for the sheep. I am the good shepherd. I know my own and my own know me, just as the Father knows me and I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep. And I have other sheep that are not of this fold. I must bring them also, and they will listen to my voice. So there will be one flock, one shepherd. For this reason, the Father loves me, because I lay down my life that may take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of my own accord. I have authority to lay it down, and I have authority to take it up again. This charge I have received from my Father. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. To you, O Lord, I lift up my soul. O my God, in you I trust. Indeed, none who wait for you shall be put to shame. Lead me in your truth and teach me, for you are the God of my salvation. All the paths of the Lord are steadfast, love and faithfulness for those who keep his covenant and his testimonies. Blessed be the Lord, the God of Israel, from everlasting to everlasting. Let all the people say, Amen. Praise the Lord. Let us pray. Almighty God, merciful Father, since you have awakened from death the shepherd of your sheep, grant us your Holy Spirit that when we hear the voice of our shepherd, we may know him who calls us each by name and follow where he leads. We pray this through the same Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated, and at this time we will invite our children to come forward to share their anthem, Living Hope.
Then through the darkness, your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Who could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages stepped down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. The cross has spoken, I am forgiven. The King of Kings calls me his own. Beautiful Savior, I'm yours forever. Jesus Christ, my living hope.
Thank you, Children's Choir, for leading us and sharing the true joy of our risen Savior, that He is our living hope, and we celebrate that each and every moment of our life. At this time, we're going to dismiss the children. If they would like to go to Children's Church, they are welcome to do so. You can meet the leaders in the back of the church, and they will take you there. A reading that we will be meditating on and looking at for our message today comes from 1 John. I encourage you, if you want to go ahead and open your Bibles, 1 John chapter 2, beginning at verse 12. And it says this, "I'm writing to you, little children, because of your sins are forgiven for his name's sake. I'm writing to you, fathers, because you know him who is from the beginning. I'm writing to you, young men, because you have overcome the evil one. I write to you, children, because you know the Father. I write to you, fathers, because you know him who is from the beginning. I write to you, young men, because you are strong and the word of God abides in you, and you have overcome the evil one. Do not love the world or the things of the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the desires of the flesh, the desires of the eyes, and the pride of life is not from the Father, but is from the world. And the world is passing away along with its desires. But whoever does the will of God abides forever." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Well, grace, mercy, peace from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. So we're going to be looking here at 1 John chapter 2 and taking a look at what this really means to us. I don't know about you guys, but when I was growing up, there was this rock group that they were old then. I don't know. They're called the Rolling Stones. Everyone loves the Rolling Stones. But in 1965, the Rolling Stones wrote a song that we probably all know the title of. You know that song, "I Can't Get No Satisfaction." And the next lyric is, "And I try, and I try, and I try, and I try." And then they all scream, "I can't get no." And everyone goes, "Oh!" You know, it's a great song. I highly recommend you look it up. Right? It is a fantastic song, but it is a song that looks at us today and talks about us today. The lyrics tell us of all the things that the world says can make us satisfied. But back then, it was kind of different than what we have today. You know, back then, it was like a white shirt. No. But then it was important, a white shirt, or how about a better relationship, or even in the lyrics it talks about those useless information. I can relate to that. Those things satisfy me. But these things that they say in the song, it could and should, it should bring us satisfaction. We all want satisfaction, don't we? You all want satisfaction in some way, in some form. Maybe this morning, satisfaction wasn't number one on your priority list of things to do. But satisfaction is something that is important to us because that is the way God made us. That is the way He wants us. He made us to be satisfied. And so we are constantly looking for satisfaction. Maybe it's going to come through the next person that you meet or through the next promotion at work or maybe it will come through the next meal that we have or that next snack that we're going to be able to get or maybe it will be in a cool toy that we're going to have. And yes, adults, we all have those cool toys, you know, TVs and cars and the tools, and we should all grunt like Tim the Toolman Taylor. It's those things. For some, maybe it's the satisfaction of getting that good grade or being a good athlete. And at this time and season of the year, maybe it's the satisfaction of getting that perfect prom date and have that perfect prom asking, whatever they call it. But what are you looking for to bring you satisfaction in your life? What are you looking for? Is it a bigger house or the best vacation or maybe it's just retirement? This whole idea, though, of satisfaction, this deep down satisfaction, it's pretty elusive. Think of it that way, you know, finding the satisfaction, it's kind of like chasing the wind, always running, never catching. So today we continue the sermon series on what it means to be real and taking a look at what real satisfaction is all about. So as we dive a little deeper into chapter 2, we're going to look at real satisfaction, this deep down satisfaction that's going to help us find this real and complete joy. But we're not going to start at verse 12. I actually want you to go to verse 15. Jump to verse 15 right away. It says this, "Do not love the world or the things in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him." That's kind of hard to hear, isn't it? If you are looking to the world, if you are in love with the world, if you're only focusing on the world, this complete satisfaction, it's a dead end. But I want you to notice what John is truly saying, though. John is not saying depart from the world or don't get engaged in the world or forget the world. He's not telling us to do that. He says do not love the world. Do not look to the world for ultimate life. Do not look to the world for ultimate joy. Do not look to the world for this ultimate satisfaction, because you won't find it. There's a third grader sitting in science class. And the teacher asked them this really deep science question. The teacher asked them, do you think the world is flat? And this third grader raised his hand and said, oh, and the teacher called on the third grader, and the third grader responded, no. So then the teacher continued quizzing this third grader and saying, okay, but then do you think the world is round? And the third grader thought a little bit. And finally said, no. Little perplexed, the teacher then goes back to that same third grader and says, okay, if the world's not flat and the world's not round, then what is the world? And it was a little pause there. The third graders, you could tell the brain was working, and he was thinking really hard, and smoke was coming out of his ears. And the third grader finally said, the world is crooked. The world is crooked. That's what John is showing us. The world is crooked. And John here, when he talks world, he's not talking in terms of a planet or the world of people. He's talking about the world in this moral sense, this corrupt, rebellious, broken, a world that loves sin, that is sick with sin, a world that is totally at odds with its creator. John is not looking for satisfaction there. He's telling us also not to look for satisfaction there. Do not look at the world. Because for many people, when you think of it, as for loving the world, it is something that you do that I don't like. If for this, that's loving the world. You not liking what I love is me saying, you got a problem. And John is also reminding us that loving the world can't be measured by those things or by many things. Loving the world can't be measured by the food I like. Loving the world can't be measured by the teams that I root for, and I'm going to get my little dib in because, you know, the NFL draft is coming, so go Pack, go, pick well. Loving the world is not going to be about the car I drive or the money I have. That's not how the world should be measured. That's not what my love should be measured by. It's not what I should look for satisfaction. John is telling us that loving the world is how much I look to it for deep down meaning, for purpose, for joy, and for satisfaction. And John is saying, don't do that. Because we get so caught up in looking to the world, and we measure it by this deep down meaning. And we kind of wonder, well, John, I don't get it. So he has to tell us, look at verse 16. He says, for all that is in the world, the desires of the flesh and the desires of the eyes and pride in possessions is not from the Father, but is from the world. Yeah, you can say a word here and there. It's from the world. Remember, John has said the world is crooked. The world is crooked and is sick with sin. So John breaks it down. He starts out by talking about the desires of the flesh. In other words, what feels good. And please note, there's nothing wrong with feeling good. God gave us feelings and God gave us desires, and that's how we were created. We can have desires and we can have feelings for many different things, and there's nothing wrong. We do that with like food and sleep, and for some crazy idea for some people, it's exercise. I don't understand. But John says that you can have those things, but be very careful. It's this. It's when the desire becomes a demand. When the desire becomes a demand, it destroys me. When the desire becomes a demand, that's lust. When desire becomes a demand, it becomes, I have to have this. And it's so easy for these legitimate desires to become demands, to make us what we want to say, to make us satisfied. But these demands, they destroy our lives because we become so engrossed in them. What feels good has become my God. What feels good has become my go-to place for satisfaction. And if you think, okay, that's good, you can stop there. John goes on. The desire of the eyes, what looks good. I don't know about you, but shiny things and reflecting things and moving things, my wife can attest to this, I get very mesmerized by. She puts me sometimes in a corner at a restaurant so I can't see things. Because it just catches my eye when I think about it. There are so many other things that I get mesmerized by. So many things that freeze me kind of in place. These dazzling lights and brilliant lights and exotic lights and exciting lights. You know what I mean. But let me make it a little bit easier for you. Crocs. I love Crocs. Wouldn't it be cool to have every color of croc? Yeah, because if I had every color of croc, I could match my crocs with my outfit each and every day. It would be so perfect. It would be like heaven, seeing this closet full of crocs. But after a few months, these crocs, they get worn out, they become dirty, and to be replaced. So what I saw at one time is good and clean and perfect has now become blah. See, if we put all our eggs into what looks good, that becomes our go-to place for satisfaction. And if those two aren't hard enough for you, he goes on and dives into this thing called pride in possessions. What makes me look good? Now, please also understand there's nothing wrong with wanting to look good. We all want that. Except here, in this case, the word pride was not actually translated as pride. It should not. It's the best translation from the word that's there is really the word arrogance. This boasting of my ability, of my accomplishments, to be in vain and to bluster. You know what this looks like. We all know people who are pompous or pretending or have this posture all the time. You all know those people that exaggerate so that they look great, that make stuff up so you think that so highly of them. We all know those people that they're going to tell you something or make sure that everyone hears it, that everyone knows it so that they look amazing. It's the desires of possessions. What makes me look good ultimately can become the source of my satisfaction. So I'm going to ask you, does this stuff work? And the answer is, let's try that again. Does this stuff work?
No.
He goes on in verse 17. And the world is passing away along with these desires, but whoever does the will of God abides forever. You have two choices. You have two fountains that you can drink from. One is passing away and one endures forever. One can care less about you and one loves you so much with this everlasting love. This crooked world is passing away. So why in the world does anyone want to follow to find ultimate satisfaction that in something that is passing away? Why would we want to do that? And that brings us back to the song by the Rolling Stones. I can't get no satisfaction, and I try, and I try, and I try, and I try. But the will of God, the person that lives in the will of God, that person will live forever. There is only one fountain that we know that can quench our thirst, that abides forever, one fountain that satisfies us deep down, and that is Jesus. You see, John wasn't dumb in his writing. John wrote some amazing stuff for us. Because now you can go back to verse 12. Because John made sure that we didn't get this first and feel down and out and feel like cruddy about ourselves. John first shares with us the gospel. He shares with us this amazing stuff. He tells us the world is going to pass away, but if you abide in God, you will remain forever. And then John goes like this. He says that your sins are forgiven, and you know him who is from the beginning. And you have overcome the evil one. John shares these amazing words with us. You see, before John dives into this other stuff, he shares with us a point that we can say, okay, it's a point that we can pause. John shares first words that mean something. Words that are present and words that are continuing ongoing. It's an ongoing, it's a present, ongoing, and enduring thing. Not only have you been forgiven, you are forgiven. You have been washed completely. And that doesn't stop at one point. It is ongoing. You know your Savior, and He calls you by name. He called you by name through the words of the gospel. And you will never stop knowing Him because of that. You will overcome the evil one. And He has taught you how. And He has done it for you. He's given you the ability to do the same. And it's not just something that you do one time. It is ongoing. Because if you abide in Him, it is forever. These gifts abide forever. And they abide forever all because of Jesus, who took away all our sin and shame, who is taken all our worldly desires, laid it upon Him upon the cross. It is Jesus. It is Jesus who abides forever. So when you're wondering what road you can take to bring you satisfaction, Please note, you can only get it through Jesus. The one who quenches our thirst, the one who fills us, the one who forgives us, the one who loves us, the one who holds us, the one who gives us the power to tell Satan to be gone. That's Jesus. So to this world, we can say, I can't get no satisfaction through you. Get real satisfaction to lead me to complete joy through Jesus. In His name, amen. Let's just take a moment and come before Him. And lay it down before Him, laying the worldly things and putting it at the foot of the cross. So we come to You, O Lord, hiding in the shadows of our own fears and terrors. We want You to give us that peace and hope in our hearts. We want You to know that everything will be all right through You. Lord, that the world will cease to be a place of terror and war in us. We want to be born again in the spirit of hope, but when we come to it for our sake, we do not lean on what You would have us to be and do in this world. So, Lord, we ask that You forgive our selfishness. We ask that You forgive us when we try to find satisfaction in other things. Calm our fears and heal our spirits. Let us truly listen to You so that we may be witnesses to Your peace and justice which You seek for the world. Saturate us with delight and wisdom. Empower us to be those who bring peace, which is not only an absence of war, but a peace which promotes an attitude of love, a peace that passes all understanding. Clear away the clutter in our lives and place us on the paths of service to you. So, Lord, we bring this all to you in your most precious and holy name. Amen. Brothers and sisters, our Lord is mighty and merciful. So in the stead and by the command of our Lord Jesus Christ, by his authority, it is my joy today to forgive you all of your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. So the Lord continues to work through us, and one he will bring it to the day of completion through him. And we celebrate that. So I want to invite you to please stand. And let's rejoice as we sing our next song.
I searched the world, but it couldn't fill me. Man's empty praise and treasures that fade are never enough. Then you came along and put me back together, and every desire is now satisfied here in your love. Oh, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing, nothing is better than you. Oh, I know that it's true. I'm not afraid. I'm not afraid to show you my weakness, my failures and flaws. Lord, you've seen them all, and you still call me friend. 'Cause the God of the mountain is the God of the valley. There's not a place your mercy and grace won't find me again. Oh, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing, nothing is better than you. There's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing, nothing is better than you. You turn mourning to dancing. You give beauty for ashes. You turn shame into glory. You're the only one who can. You turn mourning to dancing. You give beauty for ashes. You turn shame into glory. You're the only one who can. You turn graves into gardens. You turn bones into armies. You turn seas into highways. You're the only one who can. You turn graves into gardens. You turn bones into armies. You turn seas into highways. You're the only one who can. You're the only one who can.
There's nothing.
Oh, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing. Nothing is better than you. Oh, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing. Nothing is better than you.
There's nothing better than our God, because he continues to pour out his gifts upon us. So at this time, we're just going to take a moment and we're going to collect this noisy offering. So moms, dads, grandparents, friends, if you have some change, let's bring it forward and have your kids bring it forward, and we'll bring it here. I'm going to ask you, though, if you could just stay standing, because we're going to just do this pretty quickly and we're going to continue on. So let's just do that if we can. Shake this for me. All right. Shake it up. Wow. You want to take that and put it in the altar for me? Thank you. What a great sound that is to hear God's work, the gifts that he gives us. To join me in prayer. Heavenly Father, we come before you, those that are in need of help, those in need of healing. Lord, you pour out your abundant love upon them. And this love isn't something that stops at one moment. It is ongoing. It is enduring. And so, Lord, thank you, because there's nothing better than you. Lord, we pray for those that are sick. We pray for those that need a healing. For those that are hurting in some way, we lift up Anita and Amy and Becca and Fred and Joyce and Bob and Carol, Clarence, Fred, Heinke, Ryder, Susan, and Terry. Lord, we ask that you be with Mark Campbell, a father of one of our preschoolers who will be having knee surgery tomorrow. Lord, be with him through this time. We ask that you continually work and heal Sue, who had a car accident and is recovering from surgery from that accident. And Lord, we pray for Dave Schwark and Lori, his wife, as he has just received the diagnosis of cancer. Heavenly Father, we pray for love, and we ask that you pour out your grace upon them. Give them peace and comfort during this time as they're worried and wonder. We celebrate with Karen Cowell, who is recovering from surgery that she had on Friday. We are so thankful for Kimberly Bauer, who is serving you and is learning and to grow and to become a worker in your schools and for you in the church. We give you all glory and praise for gifts for all God's children, for what they do and how they impact so many. Lord, but we thank you for this place that has served you so graciously, that the people here that you have poured out your gifts upon, that just love you and continue to serve you in all things and in all ways. And so, Lord, help us also now as we prepare for this time of Sabbath. Open our hearts, talk to us, Lord. Fill us and flood us with your Spirit. Help us to step back and listen, because you are an amazing God. Help us to listen to your words, your love, your grace that you give us. Lord, we celebrate with Christine Kuzma, who has a birthday this week. Thank you for another year of life. Thank you for blessing her with so many things. And then also, Lord, thank you for these gifts that we've given. The gift from the noisy offering, the gifts that were given in the offering plate, and also, Lord, for the time and treasures and talents that you have poured upon us. Let us always use them for you. All these things, Lord, we lay before you because you are an amazing God. And those things that we may not have said that are in our hearts, we lay before you as we pray that absolutely perfect prayer you've taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. On the night when he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. When he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same way also he took the cup after supper. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." So as often as we eat this bread and we drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. And it's with that assurance that we can boldly proclaim together and say together, that is, "Amen. Come, Lord Jesus." Amen. You may be seated.
I was lost, I was in chains, the world had a hold of me. My heart was a stone, I was covered in shame, when he came for me. I couldn't run from his presence. I couldn't run from his arms. Jesus, he loves me, he loves me. He is for me. Jesus, how can it be? He loves me. He is for me. It was a fire deep in my soul. I'll never be the same. I stepped out of the dark and into the light. When he called my name, I couldn't run from his presence. I couldn't run from his arms. Jesus, he loves me, he loves me. He is for me. Jesus, how can it be? He loves me. He is for me. He holds the stars and he holds my heart, with healing hands that bear the scars. The rugged cross where he died for me, my only hope, my everything. Jesus, he loves me, he loves me, he is for me. Jesus, how can it be? He loves me, he is for me.
Gift we have received. So invite you, if you would, please stand. May the body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen and preserve you from this day forth forevermore, knowing that you are his, and he lives in you, and you live in him, and he reigns with you and walks with you and holds you forever, and the things of this world have no power over you, but he brings you the satisfaction that you want and need. So we continue to pray this prayer we've been praying, and we ask that the Lord continues to walk with us. And so that each and every moment of our lives, we are that light into the world. And so we pray, Lord, take me where you want me to go. Teach me what you want me to know. Let me meet who you want me to meet. Tell me what you want me to say. And keep me out of your way. Amen. So the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you his peace.
All of you is more than enough for all of me, for every thirst and every need. You satisfy me with your love, and all I have in you is more than enough. You are my supply, my breath of life, still more awesome than I know. You are my reward, worth living for, still more awesome than I know. And all of you is more than enough for all of me. For every thirst and every need, you satisfy me with your love, and all I have in you is more than enough. You're my sacrifice of greatest price, still more awesome than I know. You're my coming King, you are everything, still more awesome than I know. And all of you is more than enough for all of me. For every thirst and every need, you satisfy me with your love, and all I have in you, more than all I want, more than all I need, you are more than enough for me, more than all I know, more than all I can say. You are more than enough, more than all I want, more than all I need. You are more than enough for me, more than all I know, more than all I can say. You are more than enough, and all of you is more than enough for all of me. For every thirst and every need, you satisfy me with your love, and all I have in you, and all I have in you. And all I have in you, Jesus, and all I have in you is more than enough.
So go in peace and serve our amazing Lord who brings you real satisfaction. And together we say, thanks be to God. Have a great week and a blessed week, everybody.